Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Indira Ghosh from JNU. Today we are going to talk on the module QSAR and QSPR under this paper called Computational Biology. The learning objective of this module is to understand QSAR, which is called Quantitative Structure Activity or Structure Property Relationship between the compounds and the biological relations. Also, what really it means, where this method is used, and how to build these models for prediction for using the QSR. Module of QSAR or QSPR actually will deal with reason why one needs QSR or QSPR, and then how to do the methods, how to use the techniques. Why this QSR? If we take number of compounds which is required to be synthesized for a benzene ring and 10 different groups and 4 different positions, we would land up having at least 10 to the power 4 numbers of combinatorially done synthetic chemistry. It's extraordinary job for all the synthetic chemists to make those compounds. Hence, will it be easier? Yes. Can we have a solution to it? Yes. That is, we'll synthesize a very small number of compounds on benzene modified or analogs, and then find their bioactivity data, derive some simple rules to predict the biological activity, so that we can actually design newer compounds. QSAR and QSPR, or QSAR, which is quantitative structure activity relationship, and QSPR refers to quantitative structure properties relationship. There are two different bioactivity or activities are concerned. However, deals with the same problem. So, the solution almost is similar, where I deal with each one of these words. SAR is structure activity relationship. SPR is equivalent to just qualitatively structure and properties prediction or properties relationship. Like the compound with an hydroxyl tend to be active, how medicinal chemist or pharmacologist will think. Similarly, maybe second position hydroxyl can actually make a molecule to be solubilized easily. Now, QSAR is not qualitatively, it is quantitative relationship. It derives from equation like given here, that is, activity is equal to many parameters or descriptors, which is later you will know how to derive them, and set of equations like this can be regressed and find out really how many positions and how many substituents would yield our a model from where we can actually predict not only the bioactivity, even the properties like absorption, distribution, metabolism, excretion. All these properties can also be used to design QSR model or QSPR model. How does a drug get into the body and get to different part of the body? This is related to ADME. Also, how it changes while it is in the body or pass out of the body is also a part of activities measured from ADME. QSR and drug design go hand in hand, okay? Now, what we do is, actually you find some compounds, find their biological activity as shown by the top arrow, and then, once you build a model, you predict which are the new compounds will have a better biological activity. And that is shown that first we predict and shown by the bottom arrow, and we first predict and then we actually design the compound, synthesize the compound and find its biological activity. But it's not one arrow full cycle. Many such cycle actually is done to improve compounds. What is a QSAR? Actually, a QSAR or QSPR is a mathematical relationship between the property of the molecule or biological activity of the molecule or a molecular system and its geometric and physico-chemical characteristics. Actually, it is assumed and it has been well understood that the property or physicochemical property rather and the geometrical structure or conformer, etc., takes the most important roles in biologically interactive. So, it is used as the relationship between a property or activity with these descriptors, and that's how we solve the equations. It's a mathematical relationship. However, only remember that it is a mathematical relationship actually. If we can derive this mathematical relationship and consistently we have the same relationship, then only we can derive some rules, and using these rules we can build models where we can have a predictivity. However, models can be built also with rather explaining the activity, not so much with predictivity. Basically, one has to generate an equation because it is a quantitative measure and links with these properties or the biological activities. Most often, the biological activities are numbers like IC50 or some numbers like solubility 10% in octanol ethanol, or maybe log P, that is how much it is soluble and how much it is not soluble or immiscible with water. So these kind of numbers mostly are related, has to be related with the structural features of it. So we need of relationship to establish, we require rigorous statistical method. That's one important thing in it. Now, as the model suggested, any statistical model, it can be a descriptive model. Major cases in the early times, QSR was used as a descriptive model, which describes or interprets the biological function and the interactions, or physicochemical property and the biological functions. However, the model can also be delivered as a predictive model. There are plenty of new criteria one has to justify or one has to establish before we call it a predictive model, which I will talk in the last few slides. The statistical concept or mathematical regression or concept is like this. That is, if we have many descriptors like P1, P2, P3, P4 and we have series of compounds which is shown on the left hand side, compound 1, 2, 3, 4. How the biological activity, which is in the first column shown, how this biological activity of each of these compounds are related with P1, P2, P3, P4 descriptors. These descriptors are actually what is called chemical descriptors, which has been discussed earlier modules. One likes to find many descriptors, like let us say n descriptors, how it influences to the biological property, and using the bioactivity and developing many equations. For each compound, we will have one set of equations. The next slide shows the how we fit. That is, ideally, if we predict this activities from the biological known activities, we should be able to plot something like shown here. The x-axis will contain the contribution from every descriptor, that is the coefficient of these descriptors, and we will get the compounds drawn on the y-axis is actual activity. So the x-axis depicts the contribution or actual activity of each compound, and y-axis should depict the compound's activity, biological activity. Now, if we assume, and which has been always assumed in this, that this is relation of activity versus the descriptor is a linear. Hence, this equation should be able to depict this linearity and keep the linearity as shown in the picture. You require to know how to correlate between the statistically between the biological activity or properties and the chemical structures. Eventually, the chemical structures can give us many different type of properties. As we know already that these properties are predict as P1, P2, P3, the influence of each of these properties, or rather descriptors, has to be correlation function related to a correlation coefficient. And QSR regression actually is done to find the coefficient of these correlated functions. Fine. So, we start with a biological activity with respect to J, different compounds. J is different compounds, and which should be equal to giving a equation C0 plus C1 star D1, which refers as coefficient of D1 descriptor is C1. Like this, there could be n number of descriptors and n number of C's or coefficients. We also will have a plenty of numbers of equation like this, and it will depend as many compounds we use. So here we have J starting from J equal to 1 to maybe n, and number of equations, and D1, D2, D3 like that, number of descriptors in the equations. Ultimately, solving these equations, we should be able to get the C0, C1, C2, CN. As you very well see, there could be many solutions. Hence, it is done mostly by iteratively, so that error is minimized. Error means error between actual and biological predicted activity is minimized. Most often, this can be achieved by partial least square technique, which is used in computation for this such sort of structural descriptor coefficients. Biological activities can be many of them. One set of biological activity which we are very familiar is like bioactivity, that is enzyme inhibition, or like IC50, KIs, or activation, modulation, sometimes even IC99, that is at which concentration, the maximum concentration at which 99% the virus or bacteria will be dead. So there can be very many biological activities. However, this all refers to the biofunctional activity. However, a chemical also can have efficacy depending on different properties like absorbance and efficacy. Then drug metabolism or its interaction with some of the very important proteins called CYP450, etc., or cytochrome 450. Now these are the enzymes which works to remove the drug or modifies the drug so that it can be excreted. Some of times we can use these numbers as well as our bioactivity. And there are other numbers like excretion coefficient or pharmacokinetics and dynamics. Even attempt has been made to find the correlation functions for this such kind of systems. Another system has been applied very strongly is to, in the case of QSR, is the selectivity of a target and associate targets in toxicity. It is toxicity. Very interestingly, many recent papers have come up where QSR has been exclusively used in designing model for toxicity predictions. However, I must like to remind you one information. The history of the QSR started with something like this kind of prediction. Why this should be? That's the question. Why really there should be a relationship between the structural features and the biological functions? This is a slide which is done old work by Pierre Andrews in 1984, What he did is he took the drug receptor, well-known common functional drug receptors, almost 200 drugs bound to its receptor, well-known biological activities. And what he did is amongst these drugs, he find out the functions which is shown on your first column, how many of them are having sp2 carbons, how many sp3 carbons, etc. And calculated how many have carbonyl, which it can provide like hydrogen bond, something like that. These numbers were actually found out from the chemicals of these 200 drugs. And what amount of average energy it will give or provide due to the presence of these. And how many drugs has maximally how many of these numbers. These are the three things this column shows. The middle column, which says increasing average number of binding, was wonderful idea of looking at that. Then it looks like the number of, if it increases by carbon many more, then increase of binding becomes 4 times more. However, if you look at that, the bottom line, that is like availability of a carboxyl CO2-, which is provides a kilojoules per mole, almost 34.3 kilojoules per mole as an advantage. What it shows is binding capacity increases almost 1 to 10 to the power 6. And this type of things are available maximally in these drugs, 1 or 2. What it tells us? Now, this calculation was done because the binding Kc and Km were known, etc. However, what it tells us, even such a property, which are very simple position or numbers available in chemicals, can actually tell us how much the increase of binding happening. That means these are the manifestation of how the complementary surface binding to these drugs to a receptor actually is advantageous. Looking into this, the next procedure was followed, and I will elaborate in next slide that how the energy functions as well can be delivered. The term DOF is called degree of freedom, and that term actually is something which comes out when we fit an equation to all the terms depicted in the groups. Relation with this, I say 50s, and if we convert the energy or free energy available due to the increment of those positions, those which I discussed earlier, the groups, the number of groups availability, and if we can write it down in a formula, it will look like the central formula. However, on the top, I have written equation 1, which says how it explains the relation between this association constant and divided by dissociation constant, and actually it refers to Kd, where pKd is log 1 by Kd or Ki. Now, this Ki can be estimated as a free energy. However, how we calculate the free energy? Delta G free energy is shown. Now, delta G zero is the constant, which is actually refers to the degree of freedom of the molecule. However, it can have this many components. Delta G hydrogen bond, delta G metal, delta G lipo, and delta G rod. Now, here I show you the exactly the receptor point of view. That is, as previously, 200 drugs were considered and calculated. Here, 45 known ligand receptors have been included here and shown that within almost 1.4 log unit error binding constant, one can get the values of coefficient as depicted in the equation 2. That means one can actually, by increasing one level of hydrogen bonding, can provide a minus 4 point or a very preferential 4.7 kilojoules per mole energy. Now, if we have to remember one thing, that is each of these groups or each of these contribution, either the from the groups or from a group's contributions or many groups contribution are additive. In that case, this enormous ability of binding small molecule having those groups increases. However, there is a limitation. What we have come to on one thing is this relationship is taken as a linear relation. Hence, it cannot be applied to cases where there is a transport of molecule, etc. Not only that, it is only applied when the molecule is binding as a competitive inhibition. Here, I just show you a plot which says not necessarily only IC50 or KI independently if we take and expect it to have a relation, which is shown in the bottom of the equation, not necessarily they are very, very linear. Actually, if you look at the plot, this plot has been reproduced from the paper referenced down, which shows you that many actually in the lower part of KI, that is where there is a tight binders, IC50 and KI formula does not hold good. However, in the higher and middle range KI, of course, it holds good. So one must remember these conditions that not necessarily this correlation will be supplying the following rules. Hence, it is much preferable that we should work IC50 model as well as KI model. This is actually talks about the history of QSR, and it is worth to go through this before we go to the procedure of QSR and development, etc. Corwin Hans is the professor from Pomona College and his co-workers were the first group of people in 1962 actually produce elaborated examples with an example and elaboration how the QSAR or quantitative structure activity relationship can be established. They also suggested of explainable or, you know, the interpretable model. As well, they proposed predictivity of the equations. However, early in 1884, Mills observed that very simple experimental facts that melting and boiling points in a homologous series which contains CH2 groups in a chain always have a relationship between something like equation given in the right hand side. And this is that if this number, that is X, is the number of groups are in the chain is increased, and you can see this could predict the melting point very accurately up to the degree of 1 to 2 degree accuracy. Whereas that beta and gamma, etc., are some constant. However, one has to look into how this equation actually became generalized equation under the statementship of Professor Corwin Hans. Now, millions of QSR have been done and QSPR also have been done. However, there are recent development where it has been stated, especially in March 2002 in Portugal, that we should look into at least 6 guidelines so that this particularly modeling QSAR should have a best practice or a standard. And these are referenced in some of the papers as well as given here. One is it must have a defined endpoint, which means that every bioactivity or the Y function which we are predicting, we are trying to correlate with, must have an endpoint value. It should not be continuously varying business. Another thing, we must use some unambiguous algorithm which should be clearly mentioned how we derive this model. Third is how much this particular equation can be applied, which level, which state of compounds or which level of bioactivities must be defined. Fourth, appropriate statistical goodness of fit, robustness, predictivity, every number should be supported by statistical measures. Also, it should be remembered that biological functions, when we are trying to predict from chemical structure or physicochemical nature, there should be a mechanistic or some functional interpretation. Why these particular descriptors are able to express or understand the biological functions better than others. And these 5 guidelines were made to be very standard and called OECD or Organization for Economic and Cooperation and Development Principles, and all over the world was accepted as one of the standard procedure to do the QSAR. Here I show you some of the references, which is seminal references to follow. Here I speak about when to apply the QSR. Actually, when most cases in medicinal chemistry, this subject is applied maximally. And that is, this QSR are mostly used by medicinal chemist to design starting from a set of compounds. Hence, where the actual target or biological active site is not known, but many inhibitors, good and bad, already been synthesized by chemist, they use predominantly the QSR because the few activities are already tested, and one can build nice models if you have a set of compounds which already been known to be active and another set of compounds which is not active. And that's where the QSAR or quantitative structure activity relation is applied rigorously. I describe here what are the descriptor of QSR. Actually, the word descriptor came, that is, which describes a QSR equation. There could be parameters like physicochemical informations, started with free Wilson measure numbers, which are very simple and can be counted by hands by looking at the molecules. Then these are mostly thermodynamic properties. Then there are several Hansen's equations like electronic properties and Taft's equation. All these are coming from the descriptors. Then quantum chemical structures also can be converted into the descriptors. Then there are flexibility, structural flexibility, which comes from X-ray or NMR data. Then this is the most important part, is the information of the property space, that is, how good it is or how are not good it is. And this kind of descriptors, which is not only one molecular property or atomic property, which encompasses with the force field or potential energy surface, or rather to specify as a three-dimensional surface areas, can be used for COMFA or 3D QSR. Why? These descriptors, as it shows by the arrow, one can actually emphasize as 1D, 2D and 3D. Why? Because the initial is only counting the number of possible groups, which I have shown earlier. Second, you build equation with a number of descriptors and pick up the descriptors which are very relevant or highly relevant, and you should be able to make many equations, which has been depicted by Hansen's group enormously and last 50 years. Taft's equation is another, where you can actually correlate a property with some of these chemical, physicochemical informations. Then comes the second point, is compounds. So to do the compounds, you have to decide about this synthesis, because not all the compounds can be synthesized. Hence, one chooses in the beginning to develop a good QSR, a congeneric compound, i.e. that means derivatives of the same scaffold or same motif. However, one can as well do some non-congeneric or motifs which are different scaffold, provided one understands first how they can be aligned on top of each other. Now, the third is, to build the models, one can use any mathematical toolbox, and MLR, KNN, GFA, etc., etc., are very commonly well known. However, one must remember the number of equation, which is M, and versus number of descriptor, which is N, must have some certain sort of relationship, because it is very important to have many biological equations and less number of descriptors. The main reason is, there is a possibility of exploring many compounds onto less descriptor numbers. However, if too many descriptors and less number of compounds gives us a difficulty of finding which are the most influential descriptor to do this model building. One has to remember this very carefully, and it will be dealt with much rigorously in later part. Now come to the descriptors. As I discussed, that could be like topological indices, which has been discussed very much in the earlier modules. It can be quantum mechanical or quantum chemical. That also can be used. Many papers have been published with it. Physicochemical are the most commonly used molecular and atomic properties, which is most commonly descriptors are used are log P. Everyone very well know. And the major reason for using it is molecular weight, molecular refractivity, or even the points like the log D is. These are measurable quantity, gives a much explicit values and actually influences strongly to the biological activities. One can also have tested fragmental. That means we can have not only the full molecular things, but also at atom-wise certain descriptors. That also is allowed to use under the descriptor extractions. What one does then? One uses here, as I have shown the plots, first we take a training set. And training set, we should write down the numbers of training sets and have many structures. As it shown, derivatives of the same benzene ring in different positions, maybe single, maybe double derivatives. However, then we go to the descriptive space. That is, we search for descriptors and we start piling it up with many descriptors nowadays, and we calculate the descriptors, and then what we do is use a set of equation for each of these training set and try to fit it. Simple linear, multiple linear regression is one of such method by which you set up the equation and find the coefficient, as I was telling earlier. Next is to do is test. That means almost similar type of compounds which is already been known biological activity because synthetic chemistry has been worked out. But we can actually combinatorial design such compounds and test those compounds for their predictivity from our model. Once we know that, we can as well use selective compounds and try to impress or make refinement for our QSR model. Once we are sure that we are getting certain factors of quantitative measure predictability and using some statistical coefficients, which I will come to next, we start predicting for the new chemicals, which can be very well designed, synthesized, or even predicted very well. The bottom arrow shows that this information feeding is the most crucial step for doing prediction by QSR or QSPR. Here we show you simple formula of connectivity. The connectivity matrix like this can be used also as your QSR, one of the descriptors. This have been many of such descriptors have been described in earlier chemical descriptors module for your reference. As I have stated all the time, quantitative structure activity relation actually nothing but consists of solving few equations, finding the coefficient of these descriptors or contribution of each descriptors to the biological activity. So it has been depicted in this equation where I is the number of compounds and J is the number of descriptors whose values have been calculated from their chemical structures. These are called descriptors or parameters. M number of descriptors can be used. Compound number can be N. And the model has to be built. Please note, many a cases, you may get number of equations are less in number, where the compound numbers tested are very less, and descriptor numbers are very large. Reverse is also possible. That is, you have a less number of descriptors and many compounds are tested. In either cases, mathematical regression methods to be utilized to extract the correct correlation coefficients are different. Now, I just give you few examples taken from literature survey and literature papers and very small numbers in numbers to give you the flavor. Here, I show you phospholipase A2 inhibition where one knows the 188 compounds and their activity, that is log 1 by IC50. However, when we use one uses, which is given the reference, one uses the model building, one can get many descriptors, almost originally 1030 descriptors were used. And after that, you pick up all the expected descriptors, actually use certain methods to, whereas here they have used genetic algorithm method, so that it filters certain descriptors which are not so influential in the activity. And that can be done by certain clustering method, etc., which I will not go detail here. However, one must remember that at the end, how many descriptors actually were used is very important to note. And here we have used 276 descriptors. And bottom line is that number of this compound ultimately was 7. And the value of R was found to be 0.945. And Q square, which is predictivity, is 0.734. These values actually assures you that the model is quite reliable and can be explainable. However, here one has not written how the mechanistic behavior correlated with all these 276 descriptor. Until that is written, one cannot justify or predict proper molecules. However, here you must remember, we are only using the compounds and ligands, not the receptor at all. As I have told in the earlier, QSAR mostly is used where the receptor or the binding molecule structure or any interaction are totally unknown. Here is an example, the next, which should give you another example such case. Here is very well known dopamine receptor antagonist, and here also the same way is done is 41 compounds. Here the values are taken are log 1 by ED50 and the models were built up. So it can be descriptor, optimal descriptor sets can be 4, 5, many numbers, but it started with 240, landed up having very few descriptors, that is almost 23 descriptors, explain a lot of data. And the here also the value R and the Q square, that is the predictivity, is quite high. Now this has been also tested. To do the predictivity, one needs to have some test set, which I have described even earlier. But if you look at the plot of prediction versus the actual, the original, that is experimentally known, this plot gives you a feeling that it's not so well explained. Many compounds which has a very low activity has been predicted to have a higher activity than normal. And these are the difficulties, as I have mentioned, when you cannot take or you are not sure that you are covering the whole space of descriptors. Now, if the major descriptor, which is explaining the major biological activity, is missing from your set of compounds, what it says, you should be missing this kind of activities. This risk is consistently before the QSR. Here they have tried showing the descriptors which has contributed by putting red and blue colors. Blue is negative contribution, red is a positive contribution, etc. However, the same set of compounds seems to be having a contribution from a limited part of it, because the reason is, as you see, rest of the parts are very much superimposed. That is almost the similar. There's no changes happened in the rest of the molecules. These also have an effect. Please do note, these also have an effect on your predictability. How you get the 10 space structure from the previous data? And what they have done is, they have substituted at certain positions. And here it shows the predictability and how the predictable molecules have come out. Now, lowest is the log 1 by ED is 0.07, which from training sets. But these are the best structures which gives you the promising novel chemicals. Here I start few slides to put forward best practices for the good QSR model. And this is very relevant for the study here. First number, as you know, model generation always depends on the data. So first is to find the accurate data. And this is depends on the structure of the molecule which you are collecting, bioactivity or other activities of the molecule. Are you collecting the correct and appropriate data, is the assay has been done under the similar condition, all these very much influence. So most important factors is data collection. You have to have a good accuracy, you have to have a consistency, and also has to be precise data. Second point is how you calculate the descriptors. Different descriptors have a different type of values. So numerical representation must have these descriptors, must have a compositional contribution, electronic, steric, and preferably physicochemical, as many possible data should be included. Also, if one can include known experimentally determined physicochemical properties, that helps the model much better. Next point is, this data must be non-overlapping, so it should not be dependent. Like one uses molecular weight and molecular refraction, both index, both are very much correlated. Hence, one should not use correlated descriptors in this data set. Also, we must choose the descriptor which actually or eventually gives a mechanistic view of the descriptors, because that ultimately can be explainable when we build up the model. This shows hands down that how many problems we can have while data curation. And here I have shown on the left hand side, the detailed paper is referred in the bottom. Please go through the paper detail. Very, very recent publication of John Dierdale has said that 21 major errors which are associated with the QSAR predictive model. The major error in the most cases is the data curation. Here I show you on the right hand side, the left hand side shows the filter how one should use, but right hand side shows the effect of not filtering properly or not curating properly. If we look at four different programs which gives you the descriptor calculation of the compound which looks on the top 1, 2 and 3, there are three organometallic compound. Some of them will be rejected totally, not because it cannot take the structures of non-curated. However, some of them will give values as it shows, and that may not be the correct values. As you can see, the structural features might be different. However, if you do the curation, and there comes the most important thing, and which I show in the next slide, that is, if you do the curation, the model, only data curation, nothing but only data curation, the model actually predicts what it should predict. Many a time we get a model to predict very high values of R square or Q square or etc. And actually it comes because of this noise or because of wrong curated database. Next slide will show you the effect of data curation, which is predominantly published paper is given as a reference, which is very many usefulness of curation data. Many a times, some of the parameters or descriptors used may not be sufficiently expressing or extracting the correlations. Also, by curation, sometimes the values like R square, Q square, etc., statistical values found to be different. So, curated data, the slide next follows, shows you 90%, even 91-92% data curation, that is you lose only 10% data, still will influence the result found and significance of the results or accuracy of the results found in QSR. Hence, the importance of the data curation is very much emphasized in the next slide. Model generation is the crucial part of the QSR study. Hence, we must establish a statistical significant and consistent relationship between the target property and the descriptors. Most often to have this model generation, we used partial least square, multiple linear regression, artificial neural networks, k nearest neighbor, and the support vector machine methods. Many others also are in the frame. However, here most important factors are shown in curly parentheses, and that is one must assess by statistical means the robustness and its predictivity power. These are done by coefficient of determination or fitting of experiment and predicted values like R or R square. But that may not be enough, and that cannot assure you the good predictivity. So we may use little more than that at the level of R and R square, that is only at the level of training set. One should always remember these small rules, which has been summarized in my reference given in a paper of Alexander Topsital, that one can use if there are K descriptors and N training set compounds, that is compounds with activities. One can actually use for validation only if the number of training set is greater than 4 times more than the descriptors. This is the hand rule, as it has been actually seen most cases applicable. So at least it should be the N equations must have at least 4 times more descriptors. So if the descriptor numbers becomes very less and compound numbers is significantly also less, sometimes one can work out. However, the reverse is not possible. That is, if the number of equation, that is number of compounds are very less and you choose many descriptors, is not justifiable, and you will get a model, certainly you will get some R square, you might get a very good R square, but actually it doesn't explain all the activities or all the, hence your predictivity may go wrong. So please remember this rule very strongly. In addition, there are several other rules which I have cited here, please remember, and these are given in any standard statistics book. Please do remember one or two things like residuals. Residuals should be very low. This sometimes one does not even check. Similarly, there are other significance level, pairwise correlation, tolerance, etc. should be calculated. Here, I not only give you two very extraordinary references, I also tell you about it is important to have an internal validation. An internal validation normally is achieved by leave one out or leave many out. That means you take out a few equations or few bioactivities and you just have few number of, that means you are reducing the N, and you can calculate this validation by cross validations. Cross validations is given by Q square, as I given here, 1 minus the summation divided by the function. And Y is a measured quantity, Y prime is the predicted quantity. However, Y average is to be included into the thing. An average should be across whole set. As small the Q square, as low will be predictivity. However, it is not necessary that because the Q square is high, it's not necessary that your predictivity is very high. So this is a necessary support, but not necessary the predictivity is sufficient condition. So we have seen also with many of these publications, particularly one publication which has been referred and given here, is that you have test with a very well-known set, which is called standard testing set, called corticosteroid, which binds to globulins. And this biological binding has been made many model. And it was found there is no relation actually between R square and Q square for predicted and observed activity. Hence, what it tells you that R square as well as Q square, both has to be determined to find a good or very good practice for a proper model which you can use. Okay, so please do remember this one. This is the summary of all the criteria one must do, and details given by the previous papers. One is we must do the leave many out, or maybe the bootstrapping, that is using random trial sets. Then random trial sets can be designed and made it, and that gives a much better robustness for the model build. Then Why randomization test? That means one should shuffle the bioactivity and try to see that expected values of R square and Q square. Now, obviously, if it is low consistently, then your model building procedures all and descriptor sets are always good. It's always good. But if you find the randomized bioactive, that means any equation is fitting, consistently giving good values, that means it is a wrong descriptor set or molecule sets what we have taken it. Hence, be careful on doing it. In addition, one should do the external validation set, which should be selected from the training set in the beginning so that you can keep some test set outside the training set and properly choose them so that diversity of the molecules are retained there. Okay. Similarly, one should give all the validated, evaluated properly, R, R square, Q square, etc., etc. Also, as I have mentioned earlier, define the applicability domain. That is important, very important. If possible, one should also actually define the effective predictive domain. That means this is far less than actual applicable domains. If quantification can be done, so far so good. Now, also one can find out these things by using diversity or in the existing in the training set and test set. One can calculate similarity distance. This can be provide this effective prediction domain, you know, that is how good it is predicting in this domain. Now, so a threshold distance can be given by this equation as I showed, and y is the average and sigma is the SD of the Euclidean distance between the K and N in the training set, so that, and Z is actually an empirical constant which can be, you know, changed a bit and to see the significance, etc. Also, one can use residual standard deviation. Now, these values, and E is actually related to the your training set values, and F is the very well-known F statistics. So, detail of these are available in the papers. However, as I want to emphasize that, please do remember, it is highly important that we should check all the criteria nonetheless. The summary slide actually now tells you, we have depicted how to develop a QSAR or QSPR related to its property. Descriptors' choice, how important role they play and in the bioactivity. One needs to be very carefully choose descriptors and don't try to use only a automated system to calculate the activity, because it's a relation between that your descriptors and how much it has covered the bioactive space will be very important and will give you accuracy and higher prediction model. Now, also we have shown how to use diverse compounds when it comes to the compound selection. Some of these statistical parameters must be kept in mind, and many a times one uses many more than only a linear coefficients and to justify and judgment your good model. Many a cases it's advised to build many models, and many a times this many model system has been working better than the other models. However, quality of data, quality of your descriptor choice, and what method you use to regress and find your model, build up your model, is decisive factor for your model and predictability. So, quality of the model will always depend on what are the internal and what are the external validation state. However, it is cautiously reminded here that just building a model and exploring the chemical space is not the criteria. Kindly first validate your model, find how accurate the model can predict, and then explore the data space of chemistry. Thank you.